The two most common methods to produce a signal are the spin echo and gradient echo. This animation represents the latter method, using a gradient echo, whereas the previous animation illustrated the spin echo. Again, the top two panels show a 7x7 array of dipoles in the laboratory frame as viewed along the main magnetic axis. As in the previous example, the left side uses spin-spin dephasing, and the right side uses inhomogeneity dephasing. The timelines below are the same except for the new additional line, that of a gradient field. Again, there is an initial 90-degree pulse which initially flips the spins from the z-axis into the xy plane, and this is followed by the application of a special magnetic gradient. Instead of applying an 180-degree radio frequency pulse, as in the previous spin echo animation, gradient echo relies on the application of magnetic gradients to achieve a similar effect. Notice that when a gradient is applied, as shown by the plateau in the line graph labeled gradient, the rotating red arrows begin to dephase very quickly, and the signal represented by the sinusoidal curve labeled signal diminishes very quickly. The gradient is then reversed, which in essence has the same influence on the rotating dipoles, although in the opposite direction. Soon thereafter, you will notice the recovery of the signal displayed by the sinusoidal curve. In the example of spin echo, dephasing due to inhomogeneity is fully recovered after application of the reversing 180-degree pulse. This differs from gradient echo because the dephasing and rephasing is accelerated by the gradients, which are subject to inhomogeneities themselves. Similar to the spin echo example, the dephasing due to spin-spin coupling, as seen on the left side, is not recovered.